Hello.
Please raise your hands if you cannot hear me. I guess you can hear me. Please raise your hand if you have been to one of my speeches in China in the past couple of weeks. Please raise your hands if you were not at one of my other speeches. As I thought, most people have not been at my other speeches. So I'm going to have to focus on free software. Now, we're starting late. Will I have, can I end equally late? They will, but the point is, people find it hard to leave one of my speeches. But they sometimes do. You're not a prisoner. You're free to go at any time. First, if you take a photo of me, don't put it in Facebook or anything like Facebook. Those are monstrous surveillance engines.
No worries, no Facebook here.
There must be something. There must be something. Hey, I'm sure there's something similar that's just as bad.
I'm wishing.
Yeah, so don't put a photo of me. Actually, you shouldn't put a photo of anybody into something like Facebook, because that gives it another way to do surveillance of that person. Don't rat on your friends. Second, if you want to distribute copies of a recording of my talk, please do so only in the formats that are favorable to free software, which means the OGG formats or the WebM format. Please do not distribute them in MP anything. And above all, not in Flash, which means don't put them in YouTube, because YouTube distributes MP4 wrapped in Flash. Also, don't use QuickTime or Windows Media Player. And make sure that copies can be downloaded without running any non-free JavaScript code. Make sure the site doesn't ask people to run non-free JavaScript code the way YouTube does. And please put on the recording the Creative Commons No Derivatives license, because this is a presentation of a point of view. So, what is free software? Free software is software that respects users' freedom and community. So, it's studio. We're not talking about Yanfei. That price is a detail. We're concerned with something really important, namely users' freedom and community. So with software, there are I should explain. When a program is not free, we call it non-free, proprietary, user-subjugating software. Because every non-free program generates a system of unjust power for the developer over the users. It's digital colonization. And like any colonial system, it keeps the victims divided and helpless. Divided because they're forbidden to redistribute it, and helpless because they don't have the source code, so they can't change it. They can't even verify what it really does. And frequently it does something nasty. Frequently it's designed to do something nasty. So, in English, when we say free software, you need to think of free speech, not free beer. Understand what we're talking about. So, with software, there are two possibilities. Either the users control the program, or the program controls the users. It's always one or the other. There's no way to avoid it. When the users control the program, that's free software. Because in order for the users to have control of the program, they need the four essential freedoms. Freedom zero is the freedom to run the program as you wish for whatever purpose. Freedom one is the freedom to study the program source code and change it so that it does your computing the way you wish. Now these two freedoms give each user separately control over the program. But separate control is not enough because most users are not programmers. If you tell most users, well, go ahead and change the source code, they'll say, I don't know how. So we also need collective control over the program, which means that any group of users that want to work together are free to work together to make the program do what they want. This requires two more essential freedoms. Freedom two is the freedom to redistribute exact copies of the program, which means to give them away or sell them, whichever you wish. And freedom three is the freedom to distribute copies of your modified versions. Again, give them away or sell them, whichever you wish. So these two freedoms permit the users to work together when they wish to exercise control over the program. And the users that work together can also offer copies to the general public if they wish. They're free to do so. So with separate control and collective control, and collective control is in any group, could be two people, could be an entire country, could be the entire world, it could be all the companies in Beijing, and any group of users are free to work together. So with individual separate control and collective control, the users control the program and they make it do what the users want. But if the users don't have control, then the program controls the users and the developer controls the program, which means this program is an instrument of unjust power. Every non-free program creates a system of unjust power. So non-free software should not exist. The use of a non-free program in society is dependence. This non-free program puts its users into a position of dependence on the developer. This is a social problem. If people are using a non-free program, we should aim to save them. We should aim to discourage and ideally end the use of non-free programs. To develop a free program is a contribution to society. How much? That depends on the details. If the program is very useful, it's a big contribution. If it's hardly useful at all, it's a small contribution. But being free software, it's distributed in such a way that it contributes to society what it has to offer. But developing a non-free program is no contribution because it's a power grid and it tends to subjugate others. If the program has attractive features, they are the make attractive. Paradoxically, attractive features do not make a proprietary program better. They make it more harmful to society. The more attractive the track, more dangerous it is. So, if you have the choice between developing proprietary software and doing nothing at all, you should do nothing at all, because this way you don't do harm. And if you need a job, get a job in some other field. Don't make proprietary software. Don't encourage proprietary software. Yes, you can make money that way. You can make money by selling milk with poisonous chemicals in it. You can make money by being a corrupt politician. But you shouldn't. It's wrong. And what happens to the developers when they know they have power over the users? They feel temptation. Temptation to exploit that power to push the users down in order to make even more money. That's what the proprietary developers do. It's very common that proprietary software is malware. That is, it has intentionally developed malicious functionalities designed to hurt or mistreat users in various ways. For instance, they spy on users and send data to a server. Or they have digital handcuffs, DRM, functions designed to restrict users and stop them from doing what, of course, we know they will want to do. And then there are backdoors which receive commands from the developer or someone else to do something to the user without asking the user's permission. And sometimes proprietary software goes even further, and it's a platform for censoring the user, censorship of application programs. These are very common. Nearly every user of proprietary software is using some known proprietary malware. Let me prove it with a list of examples. Oh, thanks. Let's take this off. It needs to cool off before I can read it. I don't understand why people try to keep their cup of tea so hot they can't drink it. It'll burn your throat or your mouth. I like, once my tea is made, I want it to cool off as fast as possible. Anyway, one proprietary package that has all four of these nasty things that you may have heard of is called Microsoft Windows. It has known spy features that send data about the use of the computer to a server. Of course, we know it's designed to restrict users, stop users from using their files and their data the way they wish. It has at least three back doors that we know of. And in Windows 8, it is a platform for censorship of applications. So Windows is malware. The Chinese government was quite wise to reject everyone. But not just Windows 8, because Windows 7 is almost as bad. The back doors began in Windows XP. Everybody should ban and reject the use of Windows because it's malware. But it's even worse. You see, one backdoor is universal. It allows Microsoft to forcibly impose software changes through the internet, which means that any malicious function not in Windows today could be forcibly installed tomorrow. So Windows is universal malware, and it has been since Windows XP. But Windows is not alone. MacOS is also malware, because it has digital handcuffs. The software in the iThings, Apple's newer monsters, so iThings is the best name for them, is much worse. It has known spy functionalities. Apple can extract a lot of data from the iThing remotely whenever it wants, and it will do so for the U.S. government. Of course, we know about the digital handcuffs to restrict what users can do. Then there are the back doors. Look, we only know of one back door to the iPhone, but Apple acknowledges it. It's for remote deletion of applications. And then there's the censorship. Apple was the pioneer in designing computers that censor the installation of applications. Users can't freely install whatever application programs they wish. They can only install the programs that Apple has approved from Apple's App Store. And when the users saw this and started finding ways to exploit bugs so they could get rid of the censorship, escape from the censorship, they called it jailbreaking. In effect, saying that those computers are jails. So that's our term for a computer that does censorship of applications. It's a jail. Apple did it first, and Microsoft followed. So Apple's operating systems are malware. Flash Player is malware. Flash Player has a feature for websites to track users. And it has the RM. So it's malware, but Flash Player is PNFA. So what? This is the example that shows that it doesn't matter whether a program is PNFA. All that really matters is whether it's free, whether it's secure. The fact that Flash Player is PNFA means that Adobe does not require users to pay to be mistreated. Angry Birds is malware. It spies on users by sending location data to a server. The software in the Amazon Swindle is malware. The official I'm talking about Amazon's e-reader, and the official name is Kindle, but I think the name Swindle fits it better, because through its functioning, it swindles users out of the traditional freedoms of readers of books. For instance, the freedom to get a book anonymously by paying cash. Amazon won't accept cash. Amazon makes the users identify themselves, so Amazon knows which books each user has read. Now, this in itself is an intolerable attack on human rights. But it's even worse because this device is a total spy. It reports to Amazon which book and which page are being read at any time. So it's a vicious device. You might even say an Orwellian device. Then there's the freedom to give the book to someone else after you read it, or lend it to various people when you wish, or sell it to a used bookstore. Amazon abolishes these freedoms with DRM, that is malicious functionalities to restrict the user, and also with an end user license agreement that says that the user can't own a book. No, all the books belong to Amazon. All the user has is permission to read the book under Amazon's choice of conditions. And then there's the freedom to keep the book as long as you wish. Amazon abolishes this through a backdoor. We know about the backdoor by observation. We saw Amazon use it. In 2009, Amazon remotely deleted thousands of books. Some reported that the books disappeared as they were reading the book. This was truly an Orwellian act. And what was the book? It was 1984 by George Orwell. The book that gave us the expression, Big Brother is watching you, through your e-reader. There was a lot of criticism, so Amazon promised it would never do this again unless ordered to by the state. If you've read 1984, that's not very comfortable. But don't worry, Amazon didn't keep the promise. The promise was just temporary to reassure people and then be forgotten. The official name of this product is the Kindle. Kindle means the start of fire. Perhaps that's meant to suggest that its real purpose is virtually burning people's books by remote control. But they're never going to get my books, because I'm never going to use a thing like that, and I hope you never will even. And forbidding people to lend each other books makes people antisocial. So this product is designed to attack social solidarity. Warn your friends in advance. Don't start using the Amazon Swindle or anything like it, because if you start getting such a way that you can't let them, then you're not anybody's friend anymore. Make sure they know this before they do it by accident, unawares of what they're doing. My last example is nearly all portable phones. Every portable phone that's digital, which means every portable phone since a long time ago, is a computer running software that can change. Now, if the user can change some of the software, it's called a smartphone. Otherwise, it's a non-smartphone, but it still has software that's someone can change, like the phone company, can remotely change the software at any time. It's a universal backdoor. And this malicious functionality has been used to listening devices that listen all the time and transmit all the time. They don't say that they're making a call, but they're transmitting the voice they hear. And you don't have to speak into the mic because they can listen from across the room. And if you think you can make it give you privacy by shutting it off, the joke's on you. Because it pretends to shut off and continues listening and transmitting. The only way to get privacy from being listened to is to take out all the batteries. Not just one, but all the batteries. There could be multiple batteries. There could be batteries that you don't recognize as batteries and are hard to remove. Some phones don't let people remove any batteries. I don't know why. In addition, just having a portable phone that's switched on or that's on and pretending to be off means that the system knows where you go. Everywhere, the system is recording where you are. When I found this out, I decided I must not have a mobile phone. There are some things that are so disgusting that we must not accept them. It's our duty not to accept them. Well, I've just given you a list of several examples of proprietary software that are used by nearly all users of proprietary software. Nearly all of them are using at least one of these examples. So that means nearly every user of proprietary software is using known instances of proprietary malware. But what about the other thousands of proprietary programs? Well, some of them are malware and some are not. But we can't tell which is which, because we can't check your source code. So every proprietary program without Freedom 1 demands blind faith. The only possible way to trust that program is with blind faith. And since malicious functionalities now are so common, proprietary software is software for suckers. If you don't want the developers to use it all the time, reject the proprietary software. It's the only way. You see, in free software, malicious functionalities are rare because the users as a community have a defense. With free software, the users control the program. If anybody spots something malicious in the program, then they can fix it. And they can tell all the other users, look what we found, and fix it. So whoever fixes it will publish the correct version, and then everybody can switch to that. It's not a perfect guaranteed defense. There is no known guaranteed defense against malicious functionality in software, except to write all your software yourself. But this is a pretty good defense, which is a lot better than no defense at all. With proprietary software, the users are totally defenseless. They're at the mercy of the developers. Proprietary software social system has been set up to put the users at the mercy of the developers. And nowadays, the developers know exactly how much power they have. They're constantly calculating how much further can we push the users. Can we find another way to push the users down so that we'll exploit them and make more money off them? They're calculating. They go to conferences where they talk about their clever ways of exploiting users. It's shameless mistreatment of the users. So, if you don't want to be stepped on, spit on it every day by your software, make sure it's all free software. I started free software movement in 1983, and I launched the project another operating system, then as the author, I could legally make it free. And then everybody would be able to use their computers in freedom by running my system. So I would give users freedom by doing technical work in my own field. I was aware of the injustice of proprietary software, which most people did not recognize as an injustice. I had the skills necessary to try to rescue people from this injustice, and it looked like nobody else would do it if not me. That meant I had been elected by circumstances to do this work. It was my duty. So I decided to develop an operating system that would be entirely free software. Because if any piece is proprietary, that piece takes away your freedom. So the system does not fully respect your freedom. In order for it to fully respect your freedom, each piece must respect your freedom. So each piece had to be free software. Then I decided to recruit others to help write it to get it done sooner. Then I decided to make it a Unix-like system as a practical matter. Unix had some technical advantages. A Unix-like system would have the same technical advantages. And if I made it compatible with Unix, all the Unix users would find it easy to switch to my system. And then I gave it the name GNU as a joke. You see, in order for it to be a play on words, it needs two meanings. The recursive acronym GNU is not Unix, it's one meaning. But the other meaning is this animal that lives in Africa. So this is an adorable GNU that needs a home. So then I announced, in 1983, I announced the project, and in 1984, I started writing. Of course, there are lots of pieces you need in an operating system. And at first, there were just a few pieces. We wrote GNU Emacs was the first piece we started using. It was the first program that I wrote that I thought was worth distributing. Before that, I wrote a bunch of small programs like CP, RM. But I didn't think anyone would care about these because if they were using Unix that already had CP and RM. Yes, these were free versions of CP and RM, but I didn't think they were important enough to bother releasing. But GNU Emacs was something Unix didn't have, and so I released it. And at that point, I had to come up with exactly how to release free programs. Well, there's an obvious way. You just put a license on it saying, do whatever you like with this. But I knew that that would lead to problems because some other developer would be able to get my free program, which said, if it said, do whatever you like with this, that means he could make a proprietary program which consisted of my program plus some improvements. And then he would offer you copies of that with no freedom at all. In other words, if I said on the program, do whatever you like with this, the freedom would not reach you, which would mean failure. Failure for the central goal, which is give users freedom. So I invented a way to prevent that called copyleft. You know, there's copyright and there's copyleft. Copyleft means that I wrote a license which says you're free to, a free software license has to give the four freedoms. That's the definition of free software license. If it gives users the four freedoms, it's a free software license. The question here is how to do it, because there are various ways to do it. That's why there are different free software licenses. So copyleft means on freedom 2 and freedom 3, redistributing exact copies and distributing modified versions, you put a condition on. The condition says when you redistribute any version of this code, you have to do so under the same license, and you have to pass along the source code to make sure that the people who get it from you get the same freedom that you got. So, we already see that pushover licenses lead to lots of people using non-free modified versions. For instance, Apple's malware system, iOS, is a modified version of BSD. BSD is released under a pushover license. So, that permits Apple to put it into a proprietary program and set it up as a jail for users. How sad. It's not that the BSD developers attack anybody's freedom. They don't do anything that is wrong. They release their code under a free license, but they could be doing something much better. They could have copyleft their code and stopped Apple from converting it into an user stream. So it's very important to insist on copylefting code, especially if you go into a field where others are not copylefting. You can be a hero by saying, I'm going to copyleft my code because I don't want to be converted into a way to subjugate others. Look at gnu.org/license/license-recommendations.html for our guide to how to choose a license for your free program. So, by 1990, we actually had the whole of a minimal view system except for one component, the kernel. The kernel is the component of an operating system that allocates the machine's resources to all the other programs you run. We started developing a kernel in 1990. I chose an advanced, elegant design based on an existing microkernel. I thought that would enable us to make a superior kernel and have it finished soon. But it turned into a research project. I don't know exactly why, because I didn't write the code. I just talked to the guy who was the employee who was writing it. But it took 6 years to get a test version. Well, that's sad. But fortunately, we did not have to wait for it, because in 1992, Mr. Torvalds, who had written a proprietary kernel called Linux, freed it. He made it free software by releasing it under the GNU General Public License, which is our principal copyleft license. Well, once Linux was free, it fit into the gap in the GNU system. And the combination, which is GNU plus Linux, was a free operating system. For the first time, you could buy a PC and run it in freedom. However, the people who fit Linux into the gap in GNU were focusing mainly on this new piece, Linux, and they perceived all the rest of the GNU system as a small add-on. So they started talking about the combination as a Linux system. And this is how it happened that millions of people are using this variant of the GNU system, and they don't know it's the GNU system. They think it's Linux. They think it was started by Mr. Torvalds in 1991. And worst of all, they think it comes from his philosophy, which it doesn't. Because he just wrote the last piece. He didn't start the whole project. But they think he did. They think everything in the system comes out of Torvalds' ideas. And they are the ideas that go by the name of open source. Torvalds doesn't believe that you deserve freedom in your computing. He doesn't believe he deserves freedom in his computing. He thinks it's fine to run proprietary software as long as it's powerful and reliable. And he has a right to and they believe the system comes from him and his philosophy, so they tend to follow his philosophy without even questioning it. They don't even consider the philosophy I told you today. They never learn to value freedom. And they go on thinking that using non-free software is okay, and they never make an effort to fight for freedom. And that's the real harm. You see, freedom sometimes requires a sacrifice. But if you don't value freedom, you won't make a sacrifice. And then your freedom can be taken away. All they have to do is offer you some convenience in exchange for your freedom, and they'll say, oh, thanks, this is very convenient. Take my freedom. Put a chain on me as long as I can get this convenience. And then you discover, some years down the line, that things are very bad all the time because of all the power they have. The term open source was coined in 1998. There were people all along in the free software community who were real members of the community. They developed free software or distributed it or used it, but they didn't agree with our philosophy of freedom. In 1998, they got together and put the term open source as a way they could talk about basically the same set of software without ever raising it as an issue of ethics and right and wrong. So with their new term, they had a choice. They had a chance to decide which ideas to bring into their discourse and which ideas to leave out. They left out the entire ethical foundation of the free software movement. They only refer to practical convenience as values. They never talk about the convenience. So we say, if you distribute a program, not just in China, it's all around the world. I get letters a few times a week from people, emails, sorry. I get emails a few times a week to say that they admire my contribution to open source. So I write back saying, I never contributed anything to open source. That's not what I stand for. And then I tell them about the difference between software and open source. Look at new.org/lot/open-source-misses-the-point.html. The point that it misses is freedom of community. I've even seen articles that call me the father of open source. So I send a letter to the editor saying, if I'm the father of open source, it was conceived through artificial insemination using stolen sperm without my knowledge or consent. Then I explain the ideas of free software, and that's the purpose of the letter, to show the readers of that periodical the ideas of the free software movement. Show we're not gone. There are articles that say that free software was a precursor to open source. In other words, claiming that open source idea of doing software. That's why, since 1998, my work focuses on giving students one this one, and writing articles and teaching people about the software. Because we can't let the open source people bury our ideas. If they bury the idea of freedom, we'll lose freedom. Our future depends above all on what we value. Some of them really disagree with claiming that we deserve something. But above all, they wanted to avoid saying that proprietary software is wrong. Because for them, that's too bad. For them, you just can't say that a common business practice is an injustice. But I think it's an injustice. We have to say something. Proprietary software is something we need to explain. Now, the programs we developed first, the GNU system, made it possible to use the system from the command line over the text terminal. But I knew from the very beginning that we needed to have graphical interfaces to make it, because the goal is to give freedom to all of you, not business. And of course, in 1983, I've already seen graphical interfaces, I've already implemented graphical interfaces twice. So that was the intention from the beginning. The X-Window system provided the low level to the graphical interface. And since that's free software, I decided to use it. At the beginning, I thought we would have to are on low levels as well. But the X-Window system doesn't deal with the higher levels of the graphical user interface. So I knew we needed that. I made three attempts to start projects to develop graphical user interfaces for you. I didn't write anything. I found other people to write. And the first two didn't finish. They didn't achieve the goal. The second one got sidetracked with developing a called Gaia, because the goal was to have the Windows system programmable using C. So he succeeded in producing Gaia, but didn't produce a graphic user interface. GNOME was the third attempt, one that succeeded. In 1997, I believe it was, I saw that we had a big problem. Namely, KDE was starting to catch on. Well, KDE was not the problem itself. KDE was the software. The problem was KDE was dependent on the library. So it was impossible to use in a because you can't use it. You couldn't use it. And KDE wouldn't run without QT. The problem was because lots of people in the software community didn't pay attention to business. So they were starting to help develop KDE. And they became very attractive. But KDE was the bait for the QT trap. So we had to do something about this. It was such a big problem. We had to do something. So I The idea was that if harmony worked, then KDE would not be a problem anymore. You could run KDE on harmony as part of a free system. The other project was Gnome. I figured this problem is so important we have to launch two attempts to correct it in parallel. We have the best chance that we succeed with one or the other. Well, it turns out the developers of Qt saw they were under a lot of pressure, and they decided to make Qt free software. Well, that was a complete success. Once Qt became free software, KDE was no longer bait for a trap. It was useful free software. Meanwhile, Gnome became a success too. So nowadays, we don't have to think of KDE as bad. It's not bad, it's survival. But the point is, always remember why Gnome exists. Gnome was started for the sake of our freedom. Started as part of the new project, which was itself started for the sake of our freedom. Well, nowadays, we don't have a problem with proprietary QT. But we have other such problems. There are other things we can't do because there is no free software to do. And this subjects me to the limitation of proprietary software. And with so many people in our community subscribing to open source tools, they're always ready to get non-free software. And people's values show have influence on their actions. It happens that in the development of one singular free program, it makes no difference whether a developer holds open source ideas or free software ideas, because in this particular limited activity, they both lead to the same activities, the same actions. So the open source developer would be thinking, the open source supporter would be thinking, I want this program to be a big success. Let's get lots of users. Whereas the free software developer is thinking, I want to give freedom to lots of people. So I'd like the program to have lots of users. And both of them work together to make the program easier to use, more reliable, better in a technical sense. So when people are working on making the program better in a technical sense, it doesn't matter whether they are free software activists or open source supporters. But when they get to other decisions, then it makes a difference because these two philosophies based on different values lead people in different directions. For instance, there are over 1,000 distributions of GNU/Linux. Nearly all of them contain non-free software because they're maintained by people who are in the open source camp. They don't value freedom. They don't think freedom is something you should make a sacrifice for. So when they see that a non-free program would make the system more convenient, they put it in. They don't care. And then there are around 10 distributions that are totally free software because they're developed by people who care about freedom. People for whom a non-free program would ruin everything. Remember, in order for the system as a whole to respect your freedom, every piece must respect your freedom. If there's one non-free piece, that takes away your freedom. You can find the list of free distros in gnu.org/distros, as well as a list of the various well-known distros explaining list of extensions and plugins. Well, some of those extensions and plugins are non-free. The Mozilla Foundation is recommending these non-free programs. This is a consequence of their alignment with open source. And a week ago, we saw that they did a horrible thing. They decided to support DRM. But supporting DRM means they put a module into Firefox whose purpose is to load in a non-free module that does DRM. Well, if they were free software supporters, they would have said, we'll go down fighting. We will never support DRM. Because DRM is an intentional attack on users' freedom. It's a malicious function to restrict what users can do. But when people hold open source views, they don't see that this is horrible. So they might surrender and help the enemy for the sake of popularity of their own. Similar issues have arisen many times in our community. Yes, open source supporters can contribute to improving free programs. And when they do that, it's a real contribution. But at the same time, if we want our freedom to be strong, we need to teach people about the issue of freedom. We need to teach people to value freedom. And that means talking about free software, talking about freedom. And reminding the people that the system is GNU/Linux and not just Linux helps us. Because when people think the system is Linux, they tend to take their ideas from Mr. Torvalds, and he's an open source supporter. But if people know that the system is really GNU, and that it was started for the sake of giving them freedom, they will think about freedom more. They'll look at what we have to say and consider it, and they might agree with us. And when they do agree with us, then they become more people who care about freedom and who will help our cause. Nowadays, people do a lot using websites. I meant to put the tea bag down, but it actually went through a hole and through another hole and ended up on the bottom. The holes are one over the other, so they went through this hole and went through the next hole. Websites. Well, websites, web pages often contain programs. They're usually written in JavaScript. And these programs can be free or proprietary, just like any other program. If the source code is available and it carries a free license, then it's free software. Otherwise, it's proprietary software. Well, many web pages contain proprietary JavaScript code, and if you don't watch out, these proprietary programs will be installed into your browser, and you'll run them without even knowing it. The browsers don't warn you that they're about to install non-free JavaScript code. So we have a program called Libre.js, which is an add-on for Firefox. just click on the address it shows you and type in, I couldn't use your site because it tried to run a non-free JavaScript program and wouldn't work without that. Please fix it. You could complain to 10 different sites each day. And the point is, you want lots of people to send them complaints. Because that way they'll realize they need to change. It's up to you to pressure them to liberate their JavaScript code. There's another thing we need to avoid, and that is service as a software substitute, or SaaS. The point is, the way to have control of your computing is to do it with your copy of a free program. There are two ways to lose control of that computer. One is if you do it with your copy of a non-free program, because the users don't control the non-free program. So using that takes away your control of your computer. The other way to lose the control is if the copy that's running is not yours, if it's in somebody else's server, and it's his copy. So, service as a software substitute means instead of doing your computing in your own computer, you send all the relevant data to somebody else's server, and it does the computing there, and sends you back the result, or it takes action based on the result. Well, then the computing is done in the server. Your computing is being done in the server, and you don't have any control over how it's done. It's equivalent to running a non-free program. It's a different technical path to the same problem, that you lose control of that computing. But actually, SaaS is even worse than just running a non-free program. I explained how some non-free programs are spyware. They send data to a server. Well, with SaaS, the user has to send all the pertinent data to the server. So it's the same result. But SaaS is even worse. I explained how some proprietary programs have a universal backdoor that allows someone to remotely impose software changes and thus change how the user's computing is done without asking the user for permission to change it. With SaaS, the server owner, of course, can install different software and change how the user's computing is done without asking the user for permission. So, it's the same result as using proprietary software with spy functionality and a universal backdoor. So SaaS is inherently equivalent to proprietary malware. So to maintain the control of your computing, you need to reject proprietary software and reject SaaS. Note that this applies to computing operations that are personally yours. Not all the things you do are your own activity. For instance, suppose you want to chat with me. That's not your own activity. That joint activity is yours and mine together. You couldn't possibly do that inside your own computer because then I couldn't participate. The issue of SaaS does not apply to these joint activities. It applies to activities which are your own that you could do inside your own computer, assuming you have the right software and the right computer. And there are other activities like chatting that you couldn't possibly do by yourself inside your own computer because they involve others. E-commerce is communication with a store. You can't do that by yourself. Searching the internet, for instance, using a search engine, you can't do that by yourself because you want to find out what's in other people's sites. So all these activities are inherently joint activities. You couldn't possibly have total control over them because they're not solely yours. But there are servers that offer to do things that are purely yours. For instance, instance, suppose you want to convert an audio signal of speech into text. That's something you could do inside your own computer if you had the right program. So it's purely yours. You should have total control over it. But there are servers that offer to do this for you. They say, send the audio signal to the server, and we'll convert it into text, and we'll send you back the text. And they know everything you say. Siri might have a nice voice, but she's a spy. So, for your freedom's sake, reject SACS. Make sure your own computing is done in your own computer. And that applies, of course, to organizations and companies, not just to individuals. The organization should make sure its own computing is done in its computer, not entrusted to some server. And, of course, entrusting your files to some service is nuts. That's entrusting your files to the NSA. So, at this point, I think I had better move on to the auction. Now, I have two items I could possibly auction. I'd like to know how much interest there is in each of them. How many of you would like to bid for this adorable dinner? Raise your hands if you'd like to get it. This is the second edition of my book of essays, The Software Free Society. It's adorable. How many of you would like copies of it? Would like to get into the book? About the same. I guess I'll try them both. First, I'll try the blue. So this is an adorable blue that needs a home. So I'm going to auction it for the benefit of the free software movement. If you have a penguin involved, you need to get it blue for your penguin. Because, as we all know, a penguin can't really function without a dinner. And when you bid, please wave your arm and shout the amount you're bidding so I can hear you. I have hearing trouble. You need to shout it clearly like this so I can hear you. When you're not bidding, please be silent. We can accept pay in actual cash and maybe a check. I guess we can add the bill. That'll work. And I'm going to start with this normal price, which is 150 RMB. Do I get 150? This is horrible. Do I get 150? How much? How much you bidding? Rock, what? 200. I've got 200. Do I get 220?
We're having a Chinese translation now.
Do I have 330 for this adorable?
有人出320元吗？现在？330元会有更高的吗？
How much？
说现在已经是330。340。
340， I've got 340. Do I get 365?
后面。
365. 500.
I've got
500. 500. Do I get 550? Let's move it along, we don't have much time. Do I get 550?
550元还有吗？550元。
This is horrible.
I've got 600.
Do I get 650? I've got 600. Do I get 650? 650 or more for
this adorable canoe? 650 or more to the free software movement to defend freedom? 650 or more? Last chance to bid 650 or more? 最后一次650元或者更多。
最后一次。How much?I've got 700.
750.
I've got 700. Do I get 750 or more?
还有人出750元吗？或者更多？
Last chance to bid 750 or more?
最后一次机会，更多，
750 or more? Going. Gone for 700. Is an adorable book that comes to home. If you buy the book, I can sign it. And bidding is the same. I'm going to start with 150 RMB. So do I get 150?
150元起拍。
How much?
200.
I got 200. Do I get 220?
233.
I got 233. Do I get 250? I've got two. How much? I've got 250. Do I get 275?
300.
Did you say 300? Okay, I've got 300. Do I get 330? Do I get 330?
330元. 330元.
330 or more do I get?
350.
How much?
350.
We'll move it, wave your arm so I can see who you are. I can't, okay, so you bid 350. Do I get 375? Do I get 375?
375, 375.
How much?
500.
I've got 500. Oh. Do I get 550? Do I get 550?
550元.
Do I get 550 or more for this adorable book? Do I get 550 or more to the free software movement to defend freedom?
550元.
550 or more. Last chance to bid 550 or more.
最后一次550元或者更多。
Last chance, going, gone for 500. So I'll take care of the purchases after my time. Now I have a little time left for questions.
Okay, 这个购买具体流程会在这个会议之后开始。
Please make your questions very brief.
然后现在是提问环节。
Thank you. This first time I met you in person, so I...
Don't get rid of the prologue. Straight to the question,
okay.
Please. There's little time.
Well, my question is, I noticed on your personal website, comment of, there are many, many critical notes. So my question is, what's the relationship for the politics and technology and the move?
Oh, well, governments should move completely to free software. It was a wise decision for China to reject Windows 8. It shouldn't reject Windows 7 and Windows Vista and Windows XP and basically and all the other proprietary operating systems and all the proprietary applications and everything else proprietary, and so should every other government in the world, because governments should make sure that they have control of their own computing. This is known as sovereignty. Non-free software attacks the computational sovereignty of any country. And using it in an agency with a critical function, especially in the army, for instance, threatens national security. We suspect, the US government suspects, that backdoors in software in military systems have been used in war. So it's foolish to take the risk. But in addition, governments should help lead the people towards freedom by encouraging the use of free software in all of society. Schools should teach exclusively free software, and since the government funds a lot of schools and has a lot of control over schools, the government should make sure they teach only free software. For our suggested government policies, look at gnu.org/philosophy/governmentfreesoftware.html. And for why schools should teach exclusively free software, look at gnu.org/education/edu-schools.html.
Hello, my question is, what is the real reason that open source attracted more engineers, attracted more users? Is this because...
Let me tell you why. First of all, in 1998, there were already quite a few businesses in the free software community. But many of those businesses also developed proprietary software products, and for them, they preferred open source because it didn't criticize them. So, with the support of these businesses in the publicity, open source made itself heard much more than we could spread the idea of free software.
So it's not because open source has better organized?
It had more marketing support, but it had more money behind it. But in addition, it's less radical. It's less shocking. You see, proprietary software is a widely practiced business method, and most people accept it. To say this is wrong seems shocking to people. They have to think about it for a while before they might possibly recognize it's true. Open source doesn't say that. It avoids the main point, which makes it easier for people to accept.
So what is the problem of GNU/Perl?
I don't know if it has one problem. The GNU/Perl is the kernel we started in 1990. But it needs a lot of work, basically. Lots of features need to be added to it if it were to be competitive to Linux. And it's not necessary. You see, we don't need, crucially, to replace the free code of Linux. We can use it. So what we urge people to work on is replacing the non-free code in Linux, the binary blobs, which are firmware programs. This requires reverse engineering. We need to do reverse engineering on the various peripherals and coprocessors to figure out how to run them with free software. This is really important because it's replacing non-free software. Replacing one free program with another, that's not necessary.
Some people have criticized on your insist on...
I can't understand the sound. Okay. You have to pronounce okay. the consonants more carefully so I can hear you.
Some people have criticized on your insist on the free software and the privacy on the data prevent the innovation of technology. But,
what's good about innovation of technology? Do we want that?
Such as the machine learning is very hard.
If a technology tramples our freedom, it's bad. So we want to prevent innovations that attack our freedom.
Innovation has to, there must be has innovation so that we can...
Innovation can be good or bad.
Okay.
I don't make innovation a goal. Basically, innovation is promoted as a goal, a mistaken goal, to distract us from other goals, like freedom, like making sure everybody gets to have a good life. But instead, we're asked to focus on innovation as the goal. But why should we want innovation? Innovations can be good or bad. Now, if you get to choose which innovations to use in your life, you will choose the ones that are good for you. But nowadays, businesses choose the innovations to impose on people. So there's no reason to think that those innovations are good for people. They're good for the businesses that decide to impose them. So it's a mistake to assume that innovation is desirable. What we must demand above all is freedom. In computing, we must demand control over the programs. If we have control over the programs, then we will accept the innovations that are good and reject the innovations that are bad. But if we don't have control, that means companies will impose innovations on us that hurt us, because they're good for those companies. So innovation is a contingent goal. Innovations can be useful, but it's a mistake to say innovation is what we want. It's a mistake to define innovation as our goal.
So basically you think that nowadays people using machine learning kind of...
I can't understand you.
So basically you think that nowadays people using machine learning technology is just wrong.
Which technology?
Machine learning.
I have nothing against machine learning. If we have a free program to do machine learning, I might use it sometimes. And you could use it too. What's wrong, do you mean data mining?
Yes, data mining.
Okay, I don't want anybody mining data about me. So I don't give them any data about me. I won't use the sites that collect data about me. I never use them. I don't want them to learn anything about me.
Thank you very much.
Well, there's some things I publish I want everybody to know. But I'm talking about my private activities. Those I don't tell to people. Except occasionally to particular friends.
Hi. I really appreciate all of your work, and one of the things I really appreciate about your whole career the most is that in the hacker community, I've noticed a really disturbing trend of rightism. I mean, like, there's the examples, there are a lot of them, but like Raymond and
yeah.
Sanj and everyone. And you actually have a coherent political vision, and it's kind of a question about your approach to broader non-technical issues, but if you look at your website, and you show a really astute awareness of the scope and the severity of the problems of basically Western imperialist corporations taking over the whole world.
And they're not all Western, you know.
No, they're not, and it's diffusing more. But what I don't understand is that, it's really unique that you bring this political awareness to the hacker community, but...
I wish it were not unique.
I wish it were not unique too.
There are too.
Yeah, I really wish
that. I know there are others.
There are. But What I really don't understand about your approach is that, I mean, how would you respond to an accusation of armchair activism? I mean, the solutions that you prescribe are basically like individual purchasing decisions and boycotts and whatnot. But then you have an essay about why a state is so important, but you say with this liberal, I mean,
I'm sorry.
I just don't understand.
I think there may be a misunderstanding. I support various kinds of action, including, for instance, supporting the Green Party in the U.S. I voted for the Green Party candidate for president, Jill Stein. I've endorsed her. I've endorsed other candidates, too. I take whatever opportunities present themselves. Now, you could, it's a what does it mean to call me an armchair activist? Well, actually, when typing, I don't like to sit in an armchair because the arms get in the way of my arms. But I did a lot of activism for free software sitting in a chair. For instance, in the 1980s, when my work was mainly writing free programs, but that's not what you mean by an armchair activist. An armchair activist doesn't do any of the work. Well, that's not what I am. I did back work, and since the 90s, my work in giving speeches, writing articles, organizing people, raising funds for the cause. So no, I don't think I am an armchair activist on the free software. But there are other causes I support. I don't have time to be a leader in those other causes because I'm focusing on free software and also on privacy. So for the other causes, all I can be is a supporter.
I guess you partially misunderstood me. I mean, what you said is all true, but I guess what I was referring to when I said what I was getting at is that I mean, supporting efforts like the Green Party and like participating in the American, lobbying for legislation and the electoral system or whatever. I guess what I'm getting at is you identify as a liberal and do you not, I mean, it just seems the causes that you do support outside of your field, they just seem really mild and not likely to accomplish anything. I mean, here there's a history where we actually gave the West a run for their money. And before Deng had his coup.
Gave the West a run for their money.
Yeah.
China has westernized. China is...
That's why I gave his past tense. I mean, there's been a coup by...
Before that, China was so tyrannical, I certainly wouldn't have liked it. That's not my idea of the way society should be. So, but... Maybe you just don't like my policy. But I am doing all the things I simply see how to do to promote the causes I stand for. I have a liberal. I'm in the U.S. sense, not in the British or Australian or Canadian sense. Nowadays, people often use the term progressive. But to me, it's the same politics. I want the state to take care of poor people and not let them starve or get sick and die and stuff like that. I want the state to provide medical care, provide education, and basically make society good for everybody in it, not just for the rich. This requires taxes. It requires higher taxes.
So, I guess I just don't see that as compatible with the political system that is bred by the economic system of free enterprise.
Well, I don't agree, and the reason is, in the 1960s, the U.S. had free enterprise, but it also had regulation of business. In the 60s and 70s, the U.S. government adopted many important laws to regulate businesses, to do things like clean up the air and the water. Back then, democracy had some force, whereas now, democracy has been overcome. Now, the U.S. is run by that's what the problem, the core of the problem. The rich have taken control over the government, the media, and basically almost any channel that the people could possibly use for democracy. Well, I don't know a solution for it. I don't know any better way to correct this problem than the ones I'm proposing
physics. I guess the plutocracy to me just seems like an inevitable consequence of free enterprise.
The reason I don't think it's inevitable is I was there when we had one and not the other. So, the other thing is abolishing private business is a very hard regime. Now, I have ideas. I propose a tax scheme that would give business a small incentive to split up. And then we would have businesses, but they wouldn't be so big. That's another avenue. I don't think we should spend more time arguing about this now, but is there any more, is there time for any more questions?
I don't think so. Any Chinese question can be translated, by the way.
And it's up to you organizers to decide how long I should be answering questions.
In the future, can free software exchange to enterprise application, such as ERP?
I can't understand. I can't hear the consonants. I can't hear the sounds. You need to pronounce each consonant very carefully. Oh, the problem was in the pronunciation. I have hearing trouble hearing consonants. So every consonant has to be pronounced carefully so I can tell which one it is.
Okay, basically he's asking whether if turned down the chance for the free software to go into the field of enterprise software such as...
We already did. There are free ERP programs.
Yeah.
So, next question. Here's somebody. Well, he's going to someone else. Okay, pick who you want. Just go to somebody fast.
Is there a free version of Facebook that I can share?
I'm afraid there's a misunderstanding here. Facebook is not a program. Facebook is not software. Facebook is a service. It's a thing you talk with, not a thing you have a copy of and run. About them are different. It makes no sense to talk about freedoms 0, 1, 2, and 3 for a service. You don't have a copy.
So is there a service that I can share photos with my friends?
But you shouldn't do it the way Facebook wants. You can send email to your friends. You can get their GPG keys and you can send private encrypted emails to your friends. It's still not ideal. You can have a website where you post whatever notices you want, and you can protect parts of it by passwords and give those to your friends. I mean, there are various ways you can communicate with people, and you can set it up to be efficient so that you can, you know, you don't have to type a lot to post each additional note, but you have to realize this is a different kind of issue because it's not about a program. Okay.
What do you think of wikis?
What do I think of what? Wikis. Oh, WikiLeaks. I admire WikiLeaks.
I want to know how can we use free software with convenience?
I can't tell you that. You have to decide what's convenient. What I say is the most important decision we make is about priorities. So for me, freedom is the first priority and convenience comes second. I will sacrifice convenience for freedom. There are many things I won't do because I consider them to be oppressive.
But for the normal people, maybe most of us think the communist is...
Well, the most important thing to say to these normal people is you should value freedom also. That's the most important lesson we can offer them. Now, we also try to give them more convenience, and that's what Gnome tries to do. So, yes, we can work on improving convenience, and if you want to help on that particular aspect of the work, join Gnome Development.
And I think the army or the government will be more value the free software than the convenience. Yeah.
Maybe it should. The government should make should protect its sovereignty in its computing.
So maybe we can first bring our free software to the government or the army. And
then, right. Yeah. Oh, 2 weeks ago. I gave a speech by video conference to a military systems purchasing event in Argentina, a conference for the Argentine and other countries' military. And I explained to them why they should insist on free software.
Okay, thank you.
I want to say that the people who are really serious about their software make their own policies. You haven't tried to make your own laptop or...
It's not feasible now. It just is not possible. The technology of personal fabrication is not advanced enough. I can't make my own. And nobody can make his own chips. I can't hear you what?
Can I make a mobile chip? Good. I get it now.
I can't hear all of that. I don't know what it would mean to release Android. Google released Android. What are you talking about?
I wanted to make one to replace Android.
Well, there is a free version of Android called Replicant.
I don't like Java.
Oh, well, then you can make GNU/Linux run on some mobile devices. The problem is, the obstacle is the peripherals that require firmware and non-free drivers. So that's the place that you can help us. If you want to help that particular site, help the reverse engineer.
Thank you very much.
Reverse engineering is extremely important because many products have hardware whose specs are secret. We can't develop free software to run the peripheral if its specs are secret. So engineering, you can help. You might want to go to the other side for a while because you've been on this side for a long time.
Do you think we need more contact with others other than DML and IRC?
Well, we certainly want a free replacement for Skype. Preferably a peer-to-peer system, one where you don't talk to any server. So,
as you see, the driver of developing software is by people's needs. And only if there are a lot of people want to use that software, then it is developed.
So, I don't think that's true. I think the drive of developing software today is mainly companies that want to subjugate people.
Okay. So if I want something, some software, but it is not present as a free software. So do you think it's
then write it. Tell us when it's ready.
Okay. Thank you.
You don't have to write it all by yourself. You can organize other people to help.
Which license should I use for a whole...
I never formulate my views that way.
Okay.
Free hardware designs is the way I would describe the issue. I'm in favor of free hardware designs, but with the state of technology today, it's not feasible or really useful. yourself, then the crucial benefit doesn't reach any. In the future, when we can fabricate our own chips and our own computers, then we should insist that all chip designs and circuit designs be free.
Okay, thank you.
Another question. How to earn money from such free software?
Well, there are various. First of all, this is a secondary question. That's the most important thing. Suppose you need to make some money, and you think of making money from programming, and someone asks you to write a non-free program. Well, that's evil. You should refuse. Suppose you work in a milk factory, and somebody says, put in this chemical, and that way we'll make more money from the milk. You should refuse. You can't justify that by profit. It's the same with non-free software. You can't justify that by profit. Well, what happens if you can't make money in an ethical way through software? What should you do? You should get some other kind of job. So that's the important point. Non-free software can't be justified by a desire to get some money. It's better to steal food than write non-free software. If you have no money and you're hungry, and your choices are to steal food or work writing proprietary software, it's less bad to steal food. But there are ways to make money doing free software. There are a lot of programmers. Several years ago, I found that the free software companies in France employ 10,000 people. So it's significant. A lot of software development is actually website development. You can do all that as free software. Somebody wants to pay you to develop the website, get the various free libraries available, write all the JavaScript code as free software and get it to them. They'll still pay you, because nobody's going to write what needs except for pay. So he'll pay you either way. You might as well put it up as free software. In addition, there are people paid by large companies to develop free programs. In addition, a lot of software development is on commission. That is, some client is paying for a certain program to be written. Well, you can do that as free software. The client will still have to pay you.
Richard Stallman 他签名的那个仪式，然后他会把那个玩偶给傅伟。
Thank you very much, Richard. Thank you very much, the audience.